Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." Somebody say, "We have seen a star."
We have seen a star.
We have seen a star. We're going to talk about that later. Let's open our Bibles to Romans chapter 8. Romans 8. Verse 19. Bible says in verse 19, For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of
God.
All right. Next scripture. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 2. I'll read that real quick because of time. "You are our epistle written in our hearts, known and led by all men. Clearly, you are an epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God. Not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of flesh, that is, of our heart." Then, Acts. Acts 11. Acts 11, verse 21 to 26. And we'll stop there. Okay. "And the hand of the Lord, was with them, and a great number believed and turned to the Lord. The news of these things came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent out Barnabas to go as far as Antioch. When he came and had seen the grace of God, he was glad and encouraged them all, that with purpose of heart they should continue with the Lord. For he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, and great many people were added to the Lord. Then Barnabas departed from Tarsus to seek Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. So it was that for a whole year they assembled with the church and taught a great many people, and the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch." All right. If we go back to the book of Matthew, the first scripture we read, you see there that the Bible says clearly that the wise men from the east, and I made emphasis there, he said, they saw the what? They saw the star. You see, the word, that little phrase there, wise men there, it could mean men of ignoble character, basically like scoundrels. But in this particular case, the wise men here are astrologers, intelligent people, men of great character, who have taken the time to study the stars. Amen? To study the stars. And what they did is that they found out that this particular star is different. This particular what? This particular star is unique. That is different. It's set apart. And that star was an evidence that the king is born. Amen?
Amen.
Now, this sounds very much like a Christmas story. And I would love to have talked about this during Christmas. But you know what? The time is now. The time is now. Amen. Amen. Okay, maybe I should go sit down. She's finished the preaching of the message. She's finished the message, you. But guess what? They saw the star. These people saw, and they knew that something is unique about this star. And they were looking for the king. That is, look, there are volumes of message in that one. And Pastor Mercer is already looking about me. He's about to jump, okay, and finish my message. No, wait for your turn. But guess what? And Pastor Chris is a little bit difficult for me to figure out what is going on in his mind right now. But when you give him the mic, he will let you know what he's thinking. But anyway, they looked at the star and they knew that a king was born. And they were on the way to go find out, what king is this? Even though we have Herod. And they were en route to present to this king gifts. But I really want to focus on that star. At night, when you look up in the sky and the stars are out, you see a lot of stars. You can see different stars. But you know what? For the astrologers to zero down on this star, it was a star with a difference. It was a star that outshined the other ones. And if you study the scripture and if you study just the usage of the word star, sometimes it's referred to, today we refer as, when we say star, we're talking about famous people. But guess what? There is no other star that is brighter, that is stronger.
Hallelujah.
And the star of the Lord.
Yes. Amen.
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 And guess what? That star, for all intents and purposes, for this morning's teaching, that star points to the king. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Points to the fact that a king is born. And guess what? You know who that star is? That star is not so much for Christ. Is pointing to the reality of the existence of Christ. And that star is you.
Amen.
That star is me.
Amen.
Talk to your neighbor and say, you are that star.
Yes. Yes.
And you are imagined this morning. So that is the basis of our topic this morning, the emergence of kingdom stars. The emergence of what? Kingdom stars. God doesn't need to have a star. He created the stars. And when he created the stars, you are one of them. And he had you in mind. Not from the perspective of being famous or of notoriety, but what we really want to look at today is that the brightness of the star was the spiritual GPS that led these astrologers or these wise men to Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
They saw his star far away from the east and they traced it and they knew where it was. My life and your life is that star. That if traced and if followed, could either present Christ in the right light, or it could distort the light, which is the true light. Amen?
Amen.
We are that star that points to the person of Christ. We are that star that tells the world how to find Christ. None of the people in the world don't know what Christ looks like. But the only way they knew it by observing you. Amen?
Amen.
I'm going to stop here and say, I have a story and I hope I'm accurate. I'm going to go on a limb. And if I'm not, just pull me by the side and tell me that it's not accurate. And God will take care of it. Gandhi, head of India. His encounter with Christianity, from what I heard, is that when he came into the church, he sat at the front. You can't sit there. It's meant, you're not a leader, you're not the pastor, you're not whatever. The treatment he got when he came to the church was disappointing to him. Gandhi. The man was disappointing to him, so he left. And one of the remarks that he made based on his impression is that, I guess in his own research, he said, if a Christian exists, he's not met one yet. And he drew a delineation between Christ and Christ followers. And that treatment that he got the first time he came shaped his mindset and permanently blocked his opportunity of becoming a Christian. Because the star that he encountered that would have pointed to the person of Christ distorted the image of the glorious light of the gospel in his own mind and permanently blocked his access point to the kingdom. You see why Jesus said that, ye Pharisees, you go far and wide, go across the nation in order to win one soul, and you make them twice the son of man.
Hallelujah.
You see? So it is that is why we read the book of 1 Corinthians. He said that 2 Corinthians 3:2, he said we are the epistles. Amen?
Amen.
We are the what? Epistles. We are the one who show the world what Christ looks like. And what we show is what they believe, because they've never met Christ before. And that forms their assumption, like the example about Gandhi that I gave you, and can either make them to run to the person of Christ or say, you know what? If Jesus is like this, I don't want to have anything to do. What kind of light are you emitting? What kind of light are you showing? What kind of light are you portraying? Is it the one that puts Christ in the right light, or the one that casts a shadow on the brightness of the kingdom of God, and that causes the bright and morning star to become a dim star? It's very important. Is very important. Very important. Because you know what? People are watching us. People are what? Watching us. Let me tell you a quick story. It's just a story. Just take it for that. Okay? When I was in high school, every morning around 7:30, I'll be walking to school. On my way to school, every morning about 7:30, not knowing that somebody is watching me. At that same time, this individual will be on his way to work in the bus, and he's always watching this student and look forward towards seeing this student going to school, because he'll be like, what is the big deal in the student going to school? He said, according to him, that this student just looked neat and well kept. And he just watched every day, he observed. And guess what happened? That was prior to him joining our church when I was in Nigeria. And when he attended the church, he saw me, said, this is the boy that I've been seeing, that I've been observing, that I observe every morning going to school, that is neat and well kept. And then when he saw that I was a worker, I was maybe teaching children and stuff like that. He could draw a correlation. Now, if I was fighting, if I was cursing somebody out, if I was doing something that was unbecoming of a Christian, he would have said, wow, now these people are really hypocrites. This one, Christian? Now, let me put a disclaimer out there. The neatness or the being organized, the neat looking doesn't mean anything. God was just drawing his attention. And God just wanted to bring his heart and use somebody who was available. I didn't. So whatever was going on was between him and God. Amen? Has nothing to do with me. If you didn't tell me, I won't know. Amen? And that doesn't mean I'm always like that. Okay, let me just put that out there. Because you know what? We all stumble. We all fail. Okay? So I gave you a good example. If it comes to my mind, I'll give you one that is not so good. Okay? Mm-hmm. Alright, so that is that. The light, the glorious light of the gospel can only be seen by flesh and blood that people can see, and not by the God that people cannot see. They only see us, and it tells us how Jesus is like. Amen? And it depends on who they see, and when they see you, and how often they see you, and if you are consistent. Or consistently consistent. Look, I've been on YouTube, and Pastor will say, don't go there. I've been on YouTube, and the things that we hear about men of God these days is not helping the cause of Christ. Let me just simply put it. I'm not going to go into any details. It's not helping the cause of Christ one bit. And it bothers me because I'm thinking, if a lot of unbelievers are looking at these things, Kai, will people actually be saved? Because if they read these things and they take these things to heart, and some are beginning to take these things to heart, and it's discouraging them. It's not encouraging them one bit, especially when Christian leaders begin to criticize and mud swing each other. It's nasty and it's cutthroat. The things that is said back and forth in the name of so-called correction. I'm going to deal with that later. But this morning, the brightness of our light and the brightness of our dawning is resident on the workings of the grace of God in our hearts and in our lives. Amen? Amen? And there are, this morning, I want to list 5 works of grace. Now, it's not a to-do list. It's the work of grace that God wants to work inside of you and inside of me so that our light can shine brighter and we can, with pinpoint accuracy, clearly point people to the person of Jesus. And with or without words, people can be saved. I heard a saying that preach the gospel, and when necessary, use words. Pastor Chris, who said that again? When necessary, use words. More of the gospel is being preached by the way we live than what we say. And I wrote it down somewhere in here. What we say and the way we live. Your life has a voice. Your life has a what? Your life has a voice. The way we live and what we say has to be consistent. If what we say and the way we live is inconsistent, the convergence of the light will not be able to point to the person of Christ. It will be negative, it will be all positive and negative, and it will not help. Amen?
Amen.
If our life is saying one thing and our mouth is saying the other, it's very confusing and very schizophrenic. And nobody wants to follow such voices. That is, you know, the Bible says that there are many voices. The voice of your life and the voice of your words. If they conflict, it becomes difficult for people to follow Christ. But I want to list five works of grace that will bring a convergence between our words and our works, and that will bring an alignment such that our life can effectively point to the person of Christ, and more souls can watch us and see us and say, you know what, I want to be like Christ. Amen?
Amen.
So let's go on this journey real quick. The first is surrender. Now, I want to mention this real quick. We're doing an acrostic this morning. If you put the word star in a vertical position, that is from top to bottom, the first letter will be S, which is what? Surrender. Let's open the Bibles to Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9, verse 23. What does it say there? It says, then he said to them all, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. This word, life here, it is talking about our soul, our thoughts, our emotions, our intellect. That is that this word, life here, that is what it's referring to. And you know what? The problem is that these days when we see many people and they behave certain way, they do certain things, and we say, oh, you know what, this person backslid or this person fell away from the faith. The question is that at first, were they actually saved? And if they were saved, did they come to the place of surrender? The surrender factor of our faith determines the brightness of our light. Amen? Many of us want to come to a Christ who will prosper us and will give us prosperity without actually surrendering our life. We actually don't know what that means at times. We don't actually know what the word surrender actually entails. Especially with the way Christianity is presented these days. Back then, Christianity is presented that you are actually literally ready to die. And that place that I read to you is not metaphoric. I did the study, I looked at it. He wasn't talking about, you know, you lay down your will and, you know, maybe, you know, you are a little addicted to chocolate and, you know, maybe, you know, you should cut down on chocolate. Maybe you eat too much, you should not eat as much. You know, maybe you sleep too much, you should lay that down, by so you are dying to the flesh. Oh. That place is actually talking about physical death. Martyrdom. Amen? Martyrdom. Being able to lay down our life for Christ. There's a time in which I think all the time, if persecution actually comes, can I actually lay down my life?
Mm-hmm.
Can I lay down my life? Can I actually lay down my life? Many of us have not experienced persecution. Amen?
Amen.
Pastor Basil told us his experience. He went to jail. And he would have gone the second time in Hong Kong, right?
In China.
When those reporters came in, He told us that story when the police came in and all that kind of stuff, and he started taking pictures, and he was taking pictures of them and back and forth. Well, God saved his soul. They would have arrested him and thrown him in jail. God blessed him. He was alive. Watchmani didn't have that luxury. Watchmani actually was thrown in jail. Watchmani is a Christian missionary to China that God used greatly. Wonderful books he wrote. He was in jail, spent a good time in jail. His wife too was in jail. And you know what? And gradually, they cut his tongue. Thank you, Pastor Chris. I'm not being gross, it's a fact. They cut his tongue so that he can stop witnessing. And he started writing a few facts. And souls were still getting saved. In jail! And at the climax of it is when they told him that his wife just died. And guess what? He died 2 weeks later. After he has emaciated thoroughly, after he has lost a lot of weight. But we don't suffer like that anymore. The only thing we suffer from is somebody says something in the church that we're not happy about, and we complain about it. And we murmur, we complain, and we get angry, and we say, if they don't take their time very well in that church, I'll stop coming. As much as I understand how you feel, I'm saying comparatively, the things that they suffered back then was worse. They didn't have the time to complain. How can you have the time to complain when they just told Stephen? And maybe you are next. Eh? How will you have the time to complain when they just arrested Peter? How will you have the time to complain when they took Paul's head off? And Peter was nailed upside down. How will you have the time? You don't have time to complain, you're in survival mode. It's either you're for Christ or you're not. Back then, it wasn't difficult to know them. It wasn't difficult. Bible says in the book of Acts that people were afraid to join them. Now we are begging them to join. Even if you are a fornicator, please join us. You know, God loves everybody. Just join us. Join the game. No, this is not a yo-yo thing. This is not ice cream. This is life. It's a matter of, Christianity is a matter of life and death. No, please join us. Who cares whether you join? It's about your life. God does. We do, but we cannot lower the standard of the Christian faith so that we can join. We cannot. We don't have that luxury. If we do, God won't. And how will God not hold us responsible? Amen? He will hold us responsible. He will hold us responsible. So, there is a need for us to surrender. Philippians 3:7-8, let's read that real quick. There is a need for us to surrender our life and to know what we are called into. I was talking to someone today, Philippians 3:8. Yet indeed, I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ Jesus, the righteousness which is from God by faith. I was talking to somebody this morning, the person was asking a question about tithes. And I said, when you give your life to Christ, when you surrender your life, surrendering your wallet is easy. When the surrenderability of your heart is in question, letting go of your money is an issue. We can talk about, is it 10%, is it 5%, is it 2%, is it 9%? Let me answer your question, it's 100%. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He who owns the slave owns everything that the slave owns. Did you hear Pastor talk about that one the other time? When the son was given the option of who to pick, the father willed everything to the to to the slave and they said, you pick anything you want. He went to the elders and the elders said, hey, who wants the slave? Who wants everything? Pick the slave and you get everything. Hey, I don't want anything else. My dad did the right thing. I'm picking the slave. You are his. I want to coin this word. When Christ died, he redeemed us. That word redeem means to buy back. And is as a buy back as a slave blood. And the blood was the price to pay to deliver you from Satan's grip. Amen? He had to die so that you won't have to die. Let me throw this in real quick for those who like the Chronicles of Narnia. When the lion who represents Christ died, you know, he had a deal with the witch. He's an allegory. He had a deal with the witch. And the witch said, you know what, he was going to kill one of the kids. And the lion said, no, witch, we shall talk privately. They went to a private place and the lion came out and said, you know what,
me
and the witch, we have reached an agreement. And the witch left and left the children. And the lion went to a slaughter. Altar. And he went there at night when the kids were sleeping. And when he went there at night, they tied him to that big rock. And they slaughtered the lion, which is a representation of Christ. And when they slaughtered the lion actually died. And the kids went there to watch, the kids, which were on the lion's side. They saw the lion kill, slaughtered, and he actually died. And they started crying, And guess what? In daybreak, they heard a thunder, like a roaring that broke the rock into pieces. And they looked back and they didn't see the lion. And they wondered, what's going on? And then they saw the lion coming out from the other end. They said, I thought you were dying. He said, yes, I died. He said, but what the witch didn't know is that when an innocent person is killed, the power behind the witch's power begins to move backwards.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
And he came back to life.
Hallelujah.
The witch did not know that. The devil did not know that by crucifying the King of Glory, many sons will come to the kingdom.
Hallelujah.
Amen?
Amen.
So surrenderability becomes very key, very crucial in this matter of redemption. And if our surrenderability is solidified, our Christian life is on the right path. We can begin to shine brighter and brighter, point people to the knowledge of Jesus Christ. The next thing is teachability. T as in Thomas, teachability. In the body of Christ, you know, we have a lot of people who do not want to be taught. Open your Bible and go to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3. Who do not want to be taught, who refuse to endure sound doctrine. That is part of the reason that we're having Sunday school every Sunday. Teaching the sound word of God, helping people grow. That's part of the reason why we have Bible study. But some people will not come to Bible study, some people will not come to Sunday school, not because they're doing anything, not because they just don't want to come, because it's a burden. They're not doing anything. Nothing is stopping them. But they just don't feel comfortable coming. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4, actually, verse 3. What does it say? It says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. I had somebody, a friend of mine, the pastor confronted him when he was about to get married. And he didn't like what the pastor said to him. Because he felt that it was his personal life, that pastor was getting to his space. And that was probably one of the reasons why he left the church. Yeah? When that time, in a way, pastor tells you something and you say, no, how can you tell me that kind of stuff? I heard somebody, you know, the pastor said, oh, you know, you traveled, I didn't even know about it. Yeah. How can the pastor ask me that I traveled and you didn't know about it? Even my boss, I don't have to tell you. This is not your boss. This is the bishop of your soul.
Mm-hmm.
There's a difference. Your boss is not accountable for your soul. Your pastor is, because God got it. Mm-hmm. Amen? People don't want to be taught anymore. What people want to hear is that as many of those who give a seed of $1,000 right now, God is going to change your position. It's a prophetic seed. And you shake your head like this. Come! Hallelujah! And you come out and give. I'm not saying that God will bless you. But where is the fruit? What's the fruit of righteousness that God requires? We are looking for seeds of prosperity so we can get fruits of blessing. But what God is more concerned about is that left. Amen?
Amen.
Nobody wants to be taught. Everybody wants to hear prosperity. And Pastor preaches it to encourage us, to strengthen us. Because there's a place for the blessing of God. But that is not the summation of the gospel. That is not the summation of the gospel. Nobody wants to be taught anything anymore. Problem, you know, these people are becoming too much for me. Let me look for another church. You want to go to a church in which, when they ask the pastor on TV about homosexuality, he begins to. He can't speak straight. I was watching the other day on YouTube, they asked the pastor about abortion, about whether it's good or not. He said he can't answer just like that. It depends on where the person is coming from. For God's sake, he's killing babies. And if you are watching me, it is killing babies, is what it is. If you are watching me online, it's killing babies, is what it is. That doesn't mean that God cannot redeem you from your past or from your present. If you come to Him, He can redeem you. But we have to know, first of all, you have to know, we know, but you also have to know that you have sinned first. And agree with God that you have sinned before God can redeem you. If you don't agree that you have sinned, then there is no redemption for you. Amen?
Amen.
So, you know, people don't want to be taught. The pastor was saying, you know, it depends. Well, it doesn't depend on anything. It's the same period. Is it black or white? No, it's gray. What is gray? It's black. It's white. Period. Today, people are so confused that they don't even know whether you are a boy, whether you are a male or a female. It depends on what you want to be called. I sure don't want to go into a toilet in which I'm not sure of who is next to me. I'm telling you right now. And if you are watching, I'm serious. I just said what I said. Don't you? Want to go to a bathroom and know that the right plumbing is beside you? I'm serious. What do you mean, you know, I was talking to somebody, the person was asking a question whether male or female. Today, you know, it's no longer been a friend. Gender lines are being raised. And it bothers me what Priscilla's generation is going to be facing. But sound doctrine is going to help with this. Sound teaching of the word is going to help. Bible study will help. Sunday school will help. You will grow. You will be able to know the truth. And the truth will make you free. You'll be able to walk in the full knowledge and understanding of the truth. It will no longer be bleak. It will no longer be gray. It will no longer be shades. It will be black. Boys, white.
Hallelujah.
You can know what you are about. When you are taught, the next thing is after teaching, after being teachable, is being available. But before we go into that, let me mention this real quick to you. One of the deadliest weapons of the enemy is a dangerous dose of pride, which renders its victims immune to corruption. This is why the scripture says pride goes before destruction. In 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 25, when Eli was correcting his children, Hophni and Phinehas, they would not listen. You know why? Because the Bible said God was going to kill them. It's not maybe God was going to discipline. He was going to kill them. And I read it in New King James Version, by the way. Lest you say that maybe what I read is not accurate. They will not listen because God was going to kill them. generation and the next and the next, if that unteachable spirit gets a hold of us, destruction is imminent. Yes. Period. If we refuse to listen to the truth, we'll be subject to lies, and lies will lead to destruction. Exactly. After Phineas, God was going to kill them. That is by the witness. And the enemy is sneaking that dose of destruction into even the body of Christ to destruct, to distort the truth, to help them to develop itchy ears and refuse to want to know the truth because the enemy wants them killed. Mm-hmm. But you know what? You are going to escape that this morning.
Amen.
And a deep knowledge is going to help you escape. Now, remember that God is patient with us. It just doesn't, judgment doesn't come that quickly. It's perpetual rebellion that breeds destruction. And you know, some people pray that, oh, you know, in the New Testament, God is a merciful God. God, he won't die. Have you read the book of Acts? Ananias and Sapphira. And somebody even said that they weren't believers, that's why they died. Look, I have heard even more recent ones that people are still dying in the body. By the way, if Ananias and Sapphira were not believers, what about in 1 Corinthians 11? 11, when Paul was saying some of you sleep. The word sleep is a metaphor that we use in Christendom to say people die. If it's unbelievers, the Bible will say die. If it's believers, they will say sleep. Amen? Exegesis for you. When we don't follow God's word, we are open to satanic attacks. And one of the things that God can do to actually help is to put us to sleep. Come on.
Amen.
And that is the cutting short of your assignments, reducing the weight of your reward and the last thing. You make it well, but the reward will not have been a shame. If you had the time to be able to do more and make your life count for him. Let's move to the next one. Reliable.
Available.
You know what Amy Seppel McPherson said? Amy Seppel McPherson, I was watching one of her videos and she said, you know, some people, they would like to be, they could be ushers. He said, but they won't. Watch the video. Some people could sing in the choir, but they won't. Some people could go join the evangelism, but
they won't.
Some people could be prayer team. Some people will come to the Bible study, but
they won't.
It's a choice. Some people are not available to be taught, neither are they available to serve. But these same people who are not available to be discipled, who are not available to serve, are the ones who are easily available to criticize. They are the ones who will say, I don't like what Pastor said during his message last week. I don't like how the praise team sounded. Sister Lois is kind of interesting. You know I don't mean that. I'm just saying what they will say. You know? I don't like where they chose for evangelism. Not that they have ever gone for evangelism before. This thing that they say we should go and evangelize in the cold. Doesn't Pastor know how cold it is? They don't plan to go. But they don't like what the decision that the pastor made. Amen? If you are not available to learn, if you are not available to serve, you'll be available to criticize. You have to pick one of them. Mm-hmm. Or you'll be different. But most of the times, it's idle hands that makes for good tools of the enemy. Be available. What use is it to know all that needs to be known about the Lord and not make him know. What use? Some will not even try to be available to witness to their fellow colleagues at work. They will invite you to their parties in the group. You will even miss Bible study because of that. And because you have to go to their party, you will not come to the vigil because you know what? It's early in the morning and you will not have slept enough. Some will even skip service. This service is taking too long. They invited me to do something on Sunday morning. It's getting too long. I have to go. My friend invited me to this, that. Amen? I'm not available for the things of God, but we're available for the things of the world. Amen? God wants us to surrender, and when we surrender, He wants to teach us. When He teaches us, He wants us to be available to be able to commit the things that have been committed to us to faithful men. Just like, but you know what? You have to be faithful first before you can commit it to faithful men. Amen? You want to pass it on. Look at that generational knowledge that is passed in Timothy. Paul talked about his grandmother, the faith that started from the grandmother Lois, and then to the mother Eunice, and then that vibrant faith was rushing. It did not lose its velocity, it did not lose its intensity, but it hit Timothy the bishop. Amen? And Timothy is able to commit the same thing he has learned from Paul to faithful men, to the point that when Demas deserted Paul asked for Timothy. Because Timothy was what? Reliable. Amen? God wants us to be reliable. I'm saying this again. It's just a wonderful example. And how bad was I giving to you? When Pastor was traveling to Nigeria the other day, and I went to his house, when I showed the pastor, said, you know, I just prayed 2 minutes ago that I let Benjamin come. Amen? You know? And I was able to help him do certain things to help him, so because he was traveling that day. Amen? I'm not saying that if you go to his house, I wasn't working that day. That's why if I was working, I'd be at work. Amen? I'm not trying to brag. I just happened to be there. I had something that I wanted to do. I God planned it that way. God heard his prayer before he even asked. And I was there. I was able to help him. Amen? God wants us all to help. Not necessarily to be pastor, I can be available to Sister Anne. There was a time, I forgot this sister, she was in my class, and I happened to call. And when I called her, she was sick. I said, you know, let me call students. You know, I called her, and when I called her, I said, oh, she's sick. She said she might not come to service the following day. I said, you know what, let me pray with you. And you know, let's just believe that if you're healed, that you will come, you actually come. I prayed with her, Sister Anne prayed with her. And you know, guess what? The Lord healed. And she was able to show up the following day. You know, Sister was available to do the work of the Lord. I was available to do the work of the Lord. And by her availability, my availability, God healed her. God healed her.
Amen.
And brought her to church the following day. And she came here and she testified. Amen?
Amen.
So, availability intensifies our light. You have surrendered. You have been bought. Now you are available. But you know what? There is something very important I want to mention as we close. Very important. See? Availability is not commendable till it goes through the transforming process to become reliable. Amen? Availability every once in a while has not been approved until it's tested in the fiery furnace of time that upgrades that availability to reliability. That is the last R, by the way. S-T-A-R, reliable. And that is the ultimate. Timothy was reliable. That's why Paul could say, come. Come help me. He wouldn't call Timothy if Timothy was not reliable. Some people are available once in a while, but when you lean on them, as far as consistency is concerned, they fail, they falter, they fumble. And they are not there. And you know what? On a broader scale, on an overview of the body of Christ, that is why the impact of the kingdom of God is reducing. Because God is finding it hard to find a reliable man that he can entrust with his power to make the kind of impact that is necessary for these last days. Amen? God is finding it hard to find people that he can really trust, that he can really depend on, that can really make the kind of shaker and mover kind of impact. Let me blow your mind with this. Open your mind to this possibility. When Jesus died, he committed a lot of things that he would have taught the disciples. He couldn't teach them. He committed them to the apostles, and the apostles continued in the teaching of the faith. But do you know that when Paul stopped, we today, we are still trying to reach where they stopped. When the non-Jew people should take it further. Mm-hmm. Amen?
Amen.
I read a poster that said powers of old. Mm-hmm. It would be wonderful if powers of old change to power like never before.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
God is looking for men that can take this gospel further. Where Paul stopped, they want us to continue. Paul is not hoping that we do what he did. Jesus said, what I did, greater works shall you do. And that is also going down the line. Paul is hoping that you do greater works. Mm-hmm. But the problem is that you and I, me included, I'm still praying to be able to do what Paul did, to be able to see the revelation he saw, to be able to have the insight and depth of revelation that he had. We are still scratching the surface. We are still hoping and praying that we get to half of what Paul did. And Paul is looking, let's say, from heaven. The Bible says we are surrounded by this cloud of witnesses. And if this cloud of witnesses were looking at us, they would say, oh gosh, we thought they would go for that. And the heart of God is grieved, because the impact, our light, our pointability to Christ has been distorted by our desire for material things, to the point that we are like demons that has deserted Paul, that has deserted the work of God. In 2 Timothy chapter 4 verse 10, he said that Demas says, having loved this world, has deserted me. Mm-hmm. Amen? Not only can our church rely, not only can our church not rely on us, we cannot even trust ourselves to be able to do the work of the Lord. Me included also. We cannot even trust ourselves. Our impact is shallow. Our revelation is poor. We cannot even defend the faith. Some of us cannot even define what salvation means. We don't even know what it is to be saved. Some of us don't even know the difference. Some of us don't know what salvation affords us. Amen?
Amen.
Some of us, if we are questioned about our faith will crack under the force of intense interrogation. Our faith is at best pathetic. This is not a message of condemnation. It's a fair reflection of what is going on in the body of Christ. Our faith is not like before anymore at all. It has fallen way beneath the line that heaven can approve as average. Yet, God is blessing us. God is increasing us. God is giving us all the things that we want. He's protecting us. He's keeping us. And he's in keeping with us. But you know what? Let me end with this. 2 Timothy. I don't want to leave you hopeless. I've presented a very sad view, a very sad reflection of the state. I just gave you the State of the Union address. The president will say, the State of the Union is strong, even though there is massive poverty. The State of the Union is strong. But the state of our faith I'm not sure if he's strong. You know why? This is why Jesus, in reflection and looking forward, he said, when, and Pastor Chris mentioned it on Friday night during prayer, when I come back, life and faith will be. He knew he would be hard. That is why the Bible says, if the righteous are scarcely saved, because there's too much of a mess in the king. Amen? Oops, did I just say that? There's too much of a mess in the king. And that mess is also encroaching and squeezing the life out of your house. So if the church is sick, forget it. The world is going to hell in a handbasket. But before we go outside, let's look at this scripture as we close. Let's look at the book of Titus. God wants to do something in the body. Amen?
Yes.
He wants to do a quick work and cut it short in righteousness. God is coming back for a church that is what?
Without
wrinkle. That is without wrinkle, without spot. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 11. Titus 2, 11. What did the Bible say there? It said, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodly and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age. It is not a command, it is an empowerment. Amen? Amen? It is not a command, it is an empowerment. God is saying that the grace of God is available to equip us in our darkest hour, in our weakest time. The state of the union is weak.
Amen.
As far as the body of Christ is concerned. But the joy is that there is new strength.
Hallelujah.
That is coming to the body of Christ in these last days.
Amen.
There is power like never before that is coming to the body of Christ.
Amen.
There is a surge of grace that is coming to deal with the end time adversity.
Amen.
For it is written that when abounds, grace abounds. Stand up on your feet. Much more grace abounds. The Bible says that at the latter days, gross darkness will cover the earth and gross darkness the people. Amen?
Amen.
But the light of God is shining in these last days. And the grace of God is that light. And that light is coming into your life, and we are going to shine. Amen.